Welcome back, everyone. I hope all of you have had enough time to work out the normalization tutorials, and I hope you didn't have any problems with it. But just in case you did, I'm going to work out some of the problems here, and the solutions for the rest are right now hidden, but I will make it visible. I made the solutions visible for those of you who wish to read it. But what I'm going to do is go over the solutions. First, I'll take a quick look at the problem, and then I'll switch over to the solution. So the first question is to find candidate keys and attribute closures. And this, I think, is relatively easy. Most of you actually got it right in the morning. But just for completeness, let's do maybe the very first one. AB determines C, D determines C, B determines C. And in all cases, we want to find attribute closure of AB and a candidate key for this schema, where the schema is ABCDE. So the solution is shown here. So first of all, the closure of AB is pretty easy. These are the, so we have these functional dependencies, and we want to find the closure of AB. So the algorithm is extremely straightforward. We start with the result as AB, and given the functional dependency ABC, we add C to the set. And then since B is part of the set, and the functional dependency BE is present, we add E to the set. Now D is not determined by anything else, so at this point, we cannot add any more, and we stop. ABCE is the closure. Now what about the candidate key? So we can start with AB, and its closure is not the whole relation. So the question is, what all got left out? And in this case, the attributes are ABCDE. D got left out. So anything which is left out from here should be considered for adding and forming a candidate key. In this particular case, D is not on the right side of any functional dependency. So you have to make D a part of any candidate key. So this is a shortcut which you can use. If it is not on the right side of any functional dependency, it had better be part of any candidate key. So D has to be added. So we add ABD. Now if you take the closure with ABD, it's clearly ABCDE, which is all five attributes. And therefore, ABD is a super key. But before we can say it is a candidate key, we have to verify that it is minimal. We have already seen if we drop E, it's no longer a super key. What if we drop B? In that case, the closure of A is A itself, nothing more. If we drop A, so the closure of BE will be just, BD will be BDE. A and C will not appear. So it's easy to see that it is minimal. Essentially, we drop one attribute at a time and see if the result is still a super key. None of the things after dropping an attribute is. So it is a candidate key. So we can do the same thing for the other cases. Now let's move to normalization to BCNF. So the question is, for each of the above set of functional dependencies, we have to decompose it into BCNF. Again, I'm just going to do it for one of these. We'll take the very first one, AB determines C, D determines C, and B determines C, the same one. We want to decompose it into BCNF. So the schema is ABCDE. So what are the steps we take? First of all, we have to check if which all of these functional dependencies is a witness to violation of BCNF. And I think it's easy to see that AB goes to C violates BCNF because AB is not a super key. D goes to E violates BCNF also for the same reason. And B goes to E also violates BCNF. So all the three dependencies cause violation of BCNF. So we can decompose R using any one of these to start with. In fact, the decomposition to BCNF is not unique. There are many possible decompositions. We already saw a case where there were two decompositions to BCNF. And here, there are in fact even more. So we are going to take each starting point and then see where that leads us. So the first decomposition, let's start with AB determines C. If you decompose using AB determines C, the first step is to create a relation ABC that is added there. And the remaining relation consists of AB and the other attributes other than C, which is ABDE. So where you get what is shown here, ABC and ABDE. Now, is ABDE in BCNF? We have the following functional dependencies: D goes to E, B goes to E, AB goes to C. Now, AB determines C is not relevant for this one, but D goes to E and B goes to E are both relevant here, and directly those are both evidence that this is not in BCNF. So, we pick one of them. Let us say we pick B determines E and decompose. So, we add BE to the result, and what is left is B and the remaining attributes after dropping E. So, that is ABD. So, what we get is, in case you missed the last part of what I said, we first decompose using AB determines C, and the two functional dependencies, we got these two relations ABC and ABDE, and these two functional dependencies B determines E and D determines E both show that ABDE is not in BCNF. So, we can choose either one to decompose on first. If you decompose on B determines E, what do we get? We get BE as one of the relations and ABDE minus the right hand side, which is E, which is ABD. So, ABDE has been broken into BE and ABD. So, the set we have got so far is ABC, BE and ABD. Now, of this, is ABC in BCNF? We have to check for subsets. Now, it turns out in this case, for any relation with three attributes, if you take a subset of size 2, if at all it is involved in a functional dependency, which is non-trivial, the right hand side will be the third attribute. So, it will automatically be a super key. So, there is no point even checking any subset of size n minus 1 if there are n attributes. So, that leaves us to check individually A, B and C. So, if you take A, B and C individually on the first relation A, B, C, using attribute closure using all of these. Okay, if you take B attribute closure, it includes E. If you take attribute closure of A, it includes only A, and attribute closure of C is only C. So, attribute closures on each subset of ABC does not give any evidence of violating BCNF. So, we conclude that ABC is in BCNF. Similarly, we have to apply the same test to ABD. Now, what do we get? ABD, if you take all subsets of size 1, the same thing happens again. B goes to E and E is not in this schema. The closure of B is just E, there is nothing more. The closure of D is just E, and again E is not in this schema. And the closure of A is A itself. So, that one is trivial. So, the net conclusion is that ABD does not violate BCNF. Okay, so, we are done at this point. So, the decomposition we get is this one. But like I said, the exact set of things we get depends on the order in which we do these things. So, now supposing we chose a different thing in the last step, say the first step is the same, we decompose on ABC, but in the last step we use DE instead of BE. Then what happens? If you look at this step, if you decompose on DE here, in this step instead of BE, if you choose DE, you will get DE, and on this side, what are the things you get? We took ABDE, decomposed it on DE. So, what we get is, what do we get here? We have to remove E in this case also, which as it turns out is the same as what we got in the previous step. So, the only difference is we have got ABD again, but instead of BE, we got DE. That is the only difference, and we have already verified that ABD is in BCNF. So, that is it. We can stop at this point. ABC is also verified to be in BCNF. Now, there are further possibilities. In the first step, instead of ABC, we could have chosen either of these, DE or BE. So, supposing in the very first step, we chose DE. So what do we get? We get DE and the remainder of the attributes except for E. So that is ABCD. Now ABCD itself can be decomposed again using what? We can decompose it using A determines BC, because AB is not a key. We have seen that AB is not a AB closure does, AB closure includes E but not D. So we can verify that for the relation ABCD, AB determines C is non-trivial and AB is not a super key, so we can decompose, we have to decompose. So what happens when we decompose this using ABC? The first relation is ABC, the second relation is the same thing minus C, which is ABD. So what did we get in the end of this? We got DE and ABC and ABD. This is the same as the one we got in the previous step. And lastly, we had the third B determines C to decompose from. So if we decompose using that first, we get BE, ABCD, and then this if we decompose again, we get BE, ABC and ABD, which is the second one. Okay, so this is the second possibility. So these are the only two decompositions that we have got using this sequence of things. However, that does not actually mean this is the only possibilities. We could have maybe you know, inferred some other dependencies and then use those to do decomposition. In this particular case, there is not much else to infer from here which would have helped us decompose. But in general, there are many more dependencies which one can infer, and we can start decomposition using any of them. So there are many, many possibilities for the final result. Okay. So note that after we decomposed once, we always did the attribute closure on all subsets, which ensures that we won't miss anything. If we had used just the given set of dependencies without doing this attribute closure on every subset, we might miss some functional dependency which shows violation. So similarly, we have for the other two sets of functional dependencies. Both the cases, we have two alternative decompositions. Lastly, we have canonical cover. Again, for the same set of dependencies, the goal is to find the canonical cover by eliminating extraneous attributes and then decompose this using here the set of dependencies is different. The dependencies we have seen so far actually don't have any extraneous attributes, I think. So we chose two other sets of dependencies to look for extraneous attributes, and they are these two. A determines CD, B determines DE, and C determines D. This is the first one, and then there is one more similar but a little bigger. So what we need to do is find the canonical cover and then decompose it into 3NF based on the canonical cover. So let us go down and see the solution to it. So first of all, to find the canonical cover, we have to check for each of these attributes to see if they are extraneous. How do we do that? So here are the dependencies. So first, let us check if C is extraneous in A determines CD. Can supposing we dropped it from here, what is left is A determines D and then the remaining ones. From that, can we infer that A determines C? We can't. If you do A closure on the remaining attributes, A closure is just A, there is nothing more. On the other hand, if we dropped D from here, you know, we will check if it is extraneous. So how do we do it? We drop D and we use the things which are left behind, which is A determines C and then these two. So remember, this procedure is only for the right hand side. For dropping something on the right hand side, the procedure is first we drop the attribute, take the resultant set of functional dependencies and apply attribute closure on the left hand side, in this case A, and see if the attribute closure includes the dropped attribute. So we have dropped D, what is left is AC and then these two. What is the A closure here? A plus will include C in right away because of this one, A determines C. And in the next round, because C determines D, it will be ACD. So what we have done is, we have derived ACD, which includes the attribute we just dropped, namely D. And therefore, D is extraneous. Now what about the other attributes? B goes to DE. If you drop D from here, we are not going to derive B determines D. There is nothing else involving B. Similarly, dropping E, we can't derive B goes to E again. So even that is not extraneous. And we also have to check this one. C goes to D. If we drop D, can we derive it back? No, we can't. There is no other dependency involving C. Similarly, we have to check the left hand sides. When we check the left hand side, it's a little bit different. The test has to be to see if the given set of dependencies, these dependencies, from this, if we do attribute closure, can we get the stronger dependency? And this particular example is not good for that. I will use the next set of dependencies to illustrate that point, the next example. So for this, the left hand side, there is nothing extraneous. So the canonical cover is this. So what do we do next? For the canonical cover, we also need one more step. If there are two functional dependencies with the same left hand side, we union them. Here there is nothing to union. So now the 3NF schema, how do we generate it from this? Well, we create a relation for each of these, AC, BDE and CD. We also check if any of these is redundant because it is contained in one of the other things. In this case, nothing is contained. So we will keep all three relations. But there is a little bit more to do. We need a candidate key. Does any of these include a candidate key? Does this first schema include a candidate key? Let us do AC closure. So how do we check that? We just take the whole relation and do closure on that set of attributes. AC plus, what does it give us? AC plus will give us ACD, and that is it, nothing more. So ACD is not a super key. So we just check for super keys and then some part of it will be a candidate key. How about BDE plus? If you see, BDE gives this and then that is it, nothing more. So BDE plus gives us only BDE, it is not a super key. Finally, if you do CD, we do not get anything more. CD plus is just, we can use this, but D is already there. So CD plus is just CD, nothing more. So none of the relations includes a super key and therefore it does not include a candidate key. Now we have to choose something as a candidate key. So which one shall we choose as a candidate? It should be minimal and it should have everything in its closure. So if you see here, a convenient one is AB, because A determines CD, B determines DE. AB plus will be AB, CD and then E, and that is the entire set of attributes. So AB is the candidate key. It is minimal because A plus and B plus are not super keys and we are done. We get this schema. Before I do the next example, I would like to take questions and see if people have understood things so far. And then I will do the last example of extraneous attributes. Bharati Vidyapit, if you have a question, please go ahead.
Sir, I have one query that can you explain us how to find out a primary key, candidate key and super key using functional dependency?
Yeah. Yeah, can you repeat?
Sir, with example, there are possible candidate key. Candidate key and super key in example. So how to find out that, how to take this candidate key we have to take?
Right. So that is what the first example did. So let me go over it once again to clarify. Yeah. So let us go back to screen share here. The first part was to find, to do attribute closure and find candidate keys. So as part of finding candidate keys, we found super keys. Now how do we do that? So there are many possible super keys and candidate keys. We do not want to waste our time enumerating every single one of them. So there are some tricks which we use, but the basic algorithm is to use attribute closure on a set of attributes and see if it includes all the attributes of the schema. If it does, it's a super key. That's the very first step. Now there are many possible super keys. Which one do we choose? So a good way is to start from the left hand sides of some of the functional dependencies here. So we do AB plus, that includes C. So there's no point adding C to the left hand side because AB plus already includes C. And AB plus also includes E. So there's no point adding E to the left hand side. What is left is D. So if there are many more attributes left, we can pick attributes which are on the left hand side of some functional dependency. So we could choose ABD, and now it's easy to see that ABD plus includes all the attributes. Okay, so attribute closure is the basic step in finding super keys. Now once we have found a super key, we want to make sure it's minimal, and that, as I told you, consists of dropping one of the attributes at a time and again doing attribute closure. If after dropping an attribute, the closure still includes all the attributes of the schema, well then we have got something smaller. Now we try again on this. Again from the smaller subset which we got, we again try to drop things. If at this stage dropping an attribute, whichever attribute we drop, it's no longer a super key, then we know the super key is minimal, and therefore we determine it's a candidate key. Like I said, there are many possible super keys, there are many possible candidate keys. Enumerating all of them exhaustively is kind of tiresome. I have not tried to do it. If you wish to do it, yes, you could automate it if you want, write a program, but it's a little cumbersome to try all possibilities.
What would be any research area in this normalization?
Okay, so the question is there any research area in normalization? Okay, let me make a small detour into research in general. Normalization was a fantastic research area in the 1970s. Okay, in the 1970s, probably many of the people here were just about born, and many were not even born back then. So it was a hot area once upon a time, but for many, many years, there has been essentially no new research in this area because all the obvious things have been done. There may be some nooks and corners here and there, and indeed there are a few papers published once in a way, but it's not an easy area to do any new work in. So if you want to do research, my advice is don't go to areas which have been beaten up many, many years ago. It is going to be very difficult to do anything new. What you want to do is pick an area which is relatively new and then see what can be done there. And one way to find out what areas are new is to read conference proceedings and journal proceedings, at least the good ones. So there are ways to find out what areas are currently of interest. That doesn't mean those are the only areas worth doing research on. So you need one of two things. Either find an area where clearly there people are actively working, so there are probably more areas in there to do something new, or find a real problem which people are not looking at and see if you can solve it. Now many times the solution might be relatively easy, there is some solution, but if you look deeper you will find that the solution has drawbacks, and you say, but I want this other thing, this which the solution doesn't give, and then see if you can get a better solution. For example, this issue of normalization, right? So everything in here was is a single schema in normal form. Now way back in 1981, this was in the 70s, this area was very hot. In the 80s it started cooling off, but still at that point somebody said, but it's not just one relation you should think about, you should think about a whole set of relations in your schema and see if there is any redundancy if you take the whole set of relations as one unit. And that led to a very interesting paper which talked about this issue. But again, all these sorts of questions have been asked. So most of the time, if you don't know the answer, if you come up with a question like this, it's good to search in the literature. Now how do you do literature search? It's actually very easy these days. Once upon a time you had to go to a library, read through a lot of papers. But today you can just go to Google Scholar. It's a wonderful resource. There's also a few others. There's Microsoft Academic and there's Sightseer and so forth. But Google Scholar does a pretty good job. So go to scholar.google.com, search for with some keywords, you will find papers on that topic. So this particular issue, I knew was an issue. I was not aware of what all work had been done on it, the set of relations. So just yesterday I did a search and I found some old papers, 1980s papers on this topic. So it's easy to find what research has happened. But if you're thinking of it as a research area, forget it, go to some other area. Okay, there are lots and lots of questions which have come on chat. In fact, there are some good questions. One of the questions is very basic. It says differentiate binary relationships from NRE relationships. Binary simply means it relates two things. NRE means it relates three or more. The next question is a good question. In the university database, why don't we have an ID for department in department table? And the answer is actually very simple. We probably should have put a department ID or department code, but we decided to keep it simple and use the name itself as the ID. So we didn't want too many attributes in relations. Whenever we showed examples, the tables became very wide. So we wanted to keep as few attributes as possible. So just like, you know, many examples use name as a ID, we decided to use the department name as an ID. In fact, it's not unreasonable for departments because very, it's not, it's never going to happen that two departments have the same name. So it's not a big deal. Can we apply normalization and functional dependencies on a view? That's an interesting question. And the answer is no, that makes no sense. A view is often got by joining data. It's not stored as such. So you absolutely do not want to bother about these things on a view unless the goal is to have a check on the underlying thing. So for example, if we have a functional dependency, if the database system supports a primary key check on a view, we can create a view which is a join or a projection as appropriate of other relations to get a relation containing exactly the attributes in a particular functional dependency. And now we declare the left hand side as a primary key for the view. And now if there's an update which violates the primary key constraint on the view, the database could detect it. Like I said, I don't know which databases, if any, support constraints on views. Theoretically, it is possible and interesting, but practically, I don't know if it's supported. But we don't want normalization on this. The sole goal is to check integrity constraints by imposing primary key dependencies on views. We are not going to normalize a view. View is not actually stored as such. It is a perhaps a join. It can be redundant. We don't care. That's not how it's stored. Okay. Another question says normalize some relation where there are two IDs. So we have a roll number and an Aadhaar number. Now both of these are perfectly valid as unique, something which uniquely determines it. So they're both super keys and they're both candidate keys, roll number and Aadhaar number. So what do we need to do to normalize? We don't need to do anything. We only need to decompose if there is a violation of some functional dependency, which shows violation of BCNF. In this case, if you have an extra attribute which is functionally determined by the first one, it doesn't really matter. I mean, they determine each other. So either of them would be a super key. If you apply the BCNF check there, where you have, let's say, roll number, Aadhaar number, and name, three attributes. That was the example which was given. Roll number, Aadhaar number, name. Roll number determines Aadhaar number and name. Aadhaar number determines roll number and name. So if you see, the only non-trivial dependencies here are from roll number and from Aadhaar number, and both of those are super keys. So BCNF is not violated. So we don't actually have to decompose it. Another question was about full dependencies, partial dependencies, and so on. So we have been using a particular terminology for functional dependencies and to define the normal forms, but other textbooks have used other forms. So for example, supposing I have AB is a candidate key. And then I have another thing, C, another attribute C, and I have a dependency like B determines C. So what we have here is that C is dependent on a subpart of a candidate key, namely B. So sec 2NF, so this, by the way, in 2NF terminology, this is called a partial dependency. Okay, so 2NF says that there should not be any non-trivial partial dependencies. So if you had something like this, where even though AB is part of a key, you have B determine C, then you want to decompose this. And what would you decompose this into? You decompose it. You decompose it into AB and BC. So that is a partial dependency. Now 3NF and BCN, 3NF is often defined in terms of what is called a transitive dependency. A transitive dependency in a schema is something of the form A determines B and in turn B determines C. Okay. So what we have with the transitive dependency is that maybe A is the super key, but B is not. But if you see that these two, partial and transitive dependencies, are both dealt with in the same way in our definition of BCNF. Essentially, we say that if you have any dependency, the left hand side had better be a super key or it should be trivial. If it is a partial dependency, the left hand side is not part of the whole candidate key. Therefore, it is not a super key. So this would also violate BCNF using our definition. Similarly, if you have a transitive dependency like this, B determines C would also violate BCNF. So in our definition, we didn't have to differentiate between these two cases. We kind of merged it into one. So some of the earlier literature in this area said first worried about partial dependencies and defined 2NF. Then they worried about transitive dependencies and defined 3NF. Other researchers said that, look, why bother about all these stages? 2NF by itself is totally useless. 3NF is useful, so we will go directly to that. And by the way, for 3NF, there is no need to distinguish between partial and transitive dependencies. All that we care for is a dependency whose left side is not a super key, and that is true in both these cases. And that is exactly what is used in the definition of 3NF and BCNF. Dependence, non-trivial dependencies whose left hand side is not a super key, and it covers both these cases. So you can find other textbooks which define 3NF in terms of transitive dependencies, but it is equivalent. Now, if you want to explore this in more detail, there is material available on the website of our book. It is not in the textbook itself, but if actually there is a question in the exercises. So in our book, we have exercises in two parts. We have practice exercises and then we have the main exercises. Now the practice exercises are actually solved. We have put up the solution on the web. So there is a question which explores the connections between these other definitions which other textbooks use and the version that we use. So in chapter 8, the practice exercises explore this and the solutions are on the book website, which is dbbook.com. So if you go to this website and go to solutions to exercises, go to chapter 8, you will find the solution. The question, of course, you will find in the book itself. So do look it up and it will tell you in detail how these two are connected. Let's take some live question now. We have Sri Buddha College, Kerala. Please go ahead.
Go ahead. Hello. Please. I have a question from today's tutorial. We did a normalization to BCNF, means decomposition to BCNF. The question was AB determines C, B determines E, B determines E. And we got, actually what answer we got is 4 tables which contains first one ABC, then DE, then BE and ABD. And the answer you gave is
So it's a good question, but you will have to repeat it so that I will write it down on the screen, and then you can tell me what I have written down is correct. So please start again and tell me. I will write down the things which you said. So the question was on which set of dependencies? The one on?
Question was to decompose to BCNF.
Yes, that's fine.
Second question in the tutor.
1 minute. Let me pull that up. So the second one was A goes to CD, B goes to DE. Is that the one?
It is A, B determines C, B determines E, and B determines C. And the solution, so my question is,
okay,
you gave two solutions, A, B, which contain three relations each.
Yes.
A, B, C, D, E, and A, B, D.
Correct.
Also, A, B, C, D, E, and A, B, D.
Yes. Those were the two solutions we gave. Correct. Did you find one more? Yeah, do tell me. What was your...
Okay. Sir, in each of these relations, we are missing one functional dependency. If we are choosing the first option, we are not able to express the dependency B determines E. Also, in the second option, if we are choosing, we are not able to express D determines E. How is this getting managed in the solution?
Okay. So, let me just show you the two things here. What we have are two possible solutions, ABC, BE, ABD, and ABC, DE, ABD. I hope you can see both of these on your screen. And the question, as I understand it, is the functional dependency D goes to E is not actually verified by the first schema. It's not preserved. So we do not have dependency preservation. I think that's your question, right? Is that correct? So if you check the dependencies on the individual relations here, those together are not going to ensure that D determines E. Is that your question? Can you verify if that is what you asked?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So this is an issue of dependency preservation. Now let's come back here and check if dependencies were preserved. Let's go back to this. So from these, are we able to verify D determines E? So let's go to the dependencies here. Yeah, so in this case, the only functional dependency involving D is D determines E. So if you take attribute closure here, D goes to E, but E is not part of ABD. Similar, that's the only place where D appears. So nothing else is there. So the answer is yes, it is not dependency preserving. That particular functional dependency cannot be verified from this decomposition unless you perform a join. So we are losing that. The other one correspondingly, does it preserve B goes to E? So what are the things we have on B? We have only B determines E. So if you do attribute closure over here, you are not going to get anything. So, yeah, so neither of these will preserve the all the dependencies. Each of them is losing one of the dependencies. So, like I said, you don't always have a dependency preserving decomposition to BCNF. If you wanted to decompose to 3NF on the other hand, I think it's easy to verify that none of the attributes here is extraneous. So, the 3NF decomposition you will get includes all these. Each of these would be a relation in the 3NF decomposition. Furthermore, none of these is a candidate key. So we would add one more thing. The candidate key here could be ABD. So we would have four relations, ABC, DE, BE, and ABD. In fact, if you see here, we have ABC, BE, ABD. The 3NF decomposition algorithm will simply add DE as one more relation there. And now there is something interesting. This is something which I would like you to note. It's important. What happened is when we applied the BCNF decomposition algorithm, the final result was in BCNF, but it was not dependency preserving. On the other hand, if we use the 3NF decomposition algorithm, we got another decomposition, which in this case also happened to be in BCNF. It is in 3NF, but in this particular case, all the things which you get out of it are also in BCNF. So the 3NF algorithm can very well be used as a first step in getting a dependency preserving decomposition to BCNF. So the first step is apply that algorithm. The second step is check the results to see if any of the results violates BCNF. In this particular case, we have already verified that none of the results violates BCNF, so we can just let it be. So what we have got is using the 3NF algorithm to get a dependency preserving BCNF decomposition. So we can have the best of both worlds. So that is one possible approach. Apply the 3NF algorithm and then decompose more if required. And if not required, leave it alone. Does that answer your question? Now the other part is, of course, why do we have this redundant schema, BE and DE? So there is another problem though. It is dependency preserving, but you know, there is something weird going on here. We got BCNF decompositions which had one less relation. How is that possible? The only way it is possible is if that relation itself is redundant, meaning all the information contained there is there in something else. So through some closure, we can get back to it. You know, so we didn't have DE, but if you did a join of these three relations, we are actually going to get back the same things. Whatever things we had for D and E, we will get back. Now, it's not dependency preserving. So you might have a state where after doing the join, you find that DE is violated, the functional dependency, D determinacy is violated, but the data in there is preserved. We are going to get it back. We are not losing any data, even though we have one relation less. We are now with Mewar University, Rajasthan. Mewar, do you have a question?
Sir, I have a question about the normalization on the unstructured data. How do we apply the normalization process on the unstructured data?
It actually makes no sense to apply normalization on unstructured data. Unstructured means you have no control on what is there. You don't know what are the attributes. It's like text. So how do you normalize text? Is there an algorithm to do it? No, there is no way. It is basically out of your control. So there can be redundant information in unstructured data, but the basic fact that there is no structure means that you can't do anything. You can't decompose because you don't know the structure. It's only when you have structure that you can actually apply any of these algorithms and do anything useful. So if you have semi-structured data like XML and so forth, then yes, it is possible maybe to apply normalization in some of these things. I'm not familiar with related work in this area. So maybe there has been work, or maybe I was wrong about normalization being dead. Maybe this normalization of XML schemas, for all I know, might be worth looking at. I've not looked at this area, I should say. But yes, if you are looking at semi-structured data where there is nesting and so on, is there an equivalent concept to normalization? And the answer might be yes. I don't know if that answered your question. We are back with Jha College, Hyderabad. If you have a question, please go ahead.
Sir, by using, you have elaborated about axiom rules. Based on axiom rules, can we able to derive primary key, candidate key, super key?
You mean Armstrong's axiom? Yeah. So the techniques which I showed you using attribute closure to check if something is a super key and so on, you could instead use Armstrong's axioms and infer you know, whole bunch of stuff and check if something is a super key or not. But it tends to be haphazard. You don't know which one to do next. There are so many possibilities. What do you do? Maybe you miss something. You missed opportunity which you could have used. So it is absolutely doable. I mean, by definition, it's doable. But Armstrong axioms are have been shown to be complete. So any functional dependency which you can derive, you can definitely derive by a series of applications of Armstrong axioms. The only question is it convenient for a human to do so? And the answer is no. Is it convenient for a computer to do so? Yes, sir. You can code an algorithm to apply Armstrong axioms. It's not all that hard. So if you are doing it as using software, yeah, that's a different story. But what we have done in the book is mostly do stuff which is easy for humans to do. As it turns out, what is easy for humans is also easy to program. So, yeah, you could very well do all of this with Armstrong axioms, but you are better off following the attribute closure approach which we have given. Okay, one last question, and then I am going to go back to the last part of today's assignment, or last but one part. Okay, one last question from
Hello.
Banipur, West Bengal.
Sir, I have a question on normalization. That is, after having a good normalization, do I still need to index the table? And will the index even affect the performance in some way after having a good normalization?
Okay. Normalization has very little to do with indexing. Indexing is a function of what queries you ask on the database. So, if you have a lot of queries which are based on, let's say, the name of a person, then you want an index on name. If you have queries which are based on part of the name of a person, then you want a different kind of index, which can index individual pieces of a name. If you have queries which are based on, let's say, course ID on the section relation, then you want an index on course ID. Even though course ID by itself is not a, it's a part of a primary key, but it's not the whole of the primary key. On the other hand, if most of the queries on section are based on year and semester first, then you want an index on year semester. So, we'll come back to indexing later, but it's not related to normalization, it's related to what queries are asked. Now, when you normalize, of course, you have broken up data, and a related issue is that if you start with a relation schema and you break it up, I did not tell you what constraints to put on the tables that you create. That's something I missed. So, first of all, what are the primary key constraints on the tables that we create through normalization? And the answer is, anytime you create a table from a functional dependency, you can immediately add a primary key declaration on the left hand side of the functional dependency. So, you know, remember in the decomposition algorithm, we took a dependency alpha determines beta and we created a relation alpha beta. Okay, you will recall that. Now, alpha is the primary key for this relation, so we can declare that immediately. But there is actually one more thing we can do. Whenever we do this, we can have a foreign key dependency from the other relation. Remember, alpha is present on both sides. We can add a foreign key dependency from the other relation to this one. So, we can ensure that the alpha values present in the other one must be present here. If it is not present, when you join it back, you will actually lose data. So, let me just write it here using a whiteboard to re-emphasize this, because it's something I missed. If I have something like a relation R on A, B, C, D, E, and I decompose it using some functional dependency, A, B determines C, let's say, and I created two relations, A, B, C, and the other one was A, B, D, E. Now, on this relation, AB will be a primary key. So, primary key AB, because if you see, we got it from this functional dependency. So, clearly AB determines the remaining attributes here because we got it from a functional dependency. So, it is going to be a super key. So, we'll just, since in SQL, you know, primary key is the only declaration available, we declare it as a primary key. Now, on this relation, this AB value should really appear in the other one. If it doesn't, we are going to have a lossy decomposition. So, we can also add a foreign key here, AB references the other relation, this one. So, let's call this R1. Okay. So, what we have is that foreign key declaration AB referencing R1 can be added in the R2 side. That is an important part of the decomposition process which we omitted. There is one more part which I didn't talk much about, and that is null values cause havoc if they are present. So, the whole decomposition theory quietly assumes that null values are not present. Supposing a null value were allowed here, in this, we had a table like this and null values were allowed. Now, first of all, what does it mean to say that you have a functional dependency where a null value occurs? It's not clear. Okay, so if there were null values, you probably should not say a functional dependency holds. But if you did for some reason and you went ahead and decomposed it, then you have a problem. If you do a join here, the common attributes are AB, but if you had a tuple in R where say one of them is B was null, okay. So in the decomposition, B will be null here and here. If you join, null is not equal to null, so that tuple will not get reconstructed in the join. So in all our decompositions, we said lossy join because we get extra join tuples. But with null values, a join can also be lossy in the sense that you do not get a tuple which you started with. So the whole theory quietly assumes that there are no null values in anywhere, so there are, wherever we have functional dependencies, there are no null values involved in those. So that is a basic assumption. If that is violated, then you know, don't have, you know, you don't use those functional dependencies. Use only ones where you know that there is no null value and use that for decomposition. I don't know if that answered your question. So these are the two points. One is the constraints on decomposed relations, and two is null values are not compatible with functional dependencies. So let me now go back to the tutorial questions. Okay. So we had done the normalization to 3NF based on canonical cover with the first one. Now our goal with the next example is to show that on the left hand side an attribute could be extraneous and how to check for it. So that is my goal here, and here we go. Let me highlight this. These are the functional dependencies which we are looking at, and we want to see what all are extraneous. Now do we have anything extraneous on the left hand side? Okay, so okay, let's just go in order and cover the whole thing. So in here what we first considered is A determines C, and intuitively it's clear that you can derive this from A determines B, B determines C, but let us just verify it using the closure. So if we drop C from here, A determines C, we take the resultant functional dependencies and see if A closure includes C, and that is very easy because A closure will add B first and then add C and we are done. So that part was easy. So we can drop A goes to C. If you drop the right hand side, we drop C, the resultant is the right hand side is empty, which is actually a trivial dependency. A determines nothing is trivial, so we can drop it. Now let us look at AD determines E. We want to check if A is extraneous here. For this it is actually the check is slightly different. If you compare AD goes to E with, if you drop A we get D goes to E. D goes to E is a stronger statement. When you drop it from the right hand side, you are weakening it. When you are weakening it, your goal is to check if the original thing can be derived from the weakened set, then they are equivalent. Our goal is equivalence. If you take something and weaken it, you want to see if the weakened thing implies the original, then you are okay. But here the goal is different. If you are dropping it from the left hand side, you are strengthening it. If you want to strengthen it, you have to show the stronger thing can be derived from the original set of functional dependencies. So in this case we want to check if we can derive D goes to E from the original set, from what is given here. So we apply attribute closure on D, and here it is actually trivial. There is directly a functional dependency D goes to E. So the attribute closure of D includes E, and therefore A is extraneous here, we can drop it. So if you want to do it in two steps, we first take the result of deleting A, D goes to E, we check if it can be derived, indeed it can be derived, and so we add it, and once we add it, AD goes to E is weaker than that and we can drop it. So this is what we get, and this is the set of dependencies we get: AB, BC, DE, and BE. DE is already present, so when we deleted this, that got merged. So this is what we get. And now there are two things with the same left hand side, B. So we union those, and this is the canonical cover. And if you want to use the synthesis algorithm, we create a relation from each of these. Is any of them redundant? Is AB contained in the others? No. DE contained in others? No. We also have to check if any of them contains a candidate key, and you can easily verify that none of them does. Why? If we look at this set of dependencies, if you take any of these, AB plus does not include D. If you take AC plus, that again does not include D. If you take AE plus, that does not include D either. On the other hand, if you take AD plus, that includes everything. You can easily see that AD plus has B, and then you can add C, and then you can add E. So we have everything. A, B, C, D, E are all contained in AD plus. And we can verify that it is minimal, so it is a candidate key. So the final schema has these three plus AD, and this is what we have. This is the final result of 3NF synthesis algorithm run on this particular set of dependencies. I hope that was clear. There is one more part to this, which is taking a student and adding the functional dependencies on that. I will leave it to you to read it. I do not think it is particularly hard, it is fairly straightforward. So we can take a last few questions and then wrap up today. We are half an hour beyond, so I will take a last few questions and then wrap up. Yeah, D.Y. Patil, please go ahead.
We are having a question on BCNF relations testing.
Okay.
Suppose, sir, we are having three different functional dependencies. First two functional dependencies violates the BCNF conditions.
Yeah.
But using the third function dependency, we satisfies the BCNF.
Okay.
So can that relation schema is in a BCNF or not?
It is not in BCNF. For it to be in BCNF, every single functional dependency which is given or which you can infer, every single one of them should either be trivial or the left hand side should be a super key. So if there is even one functional dependency which violates this condition, that is the left hand side is not a super key and it is not trivial, then the relation is not in BCNF, we have to decompose it. So it is not enough if one of them, one of the dependencies is okay, all the dependencies have to be okay.
Can you give some example for fifth normal form, sir?
Fifth normal form, that is based on joint dependencies. I do not have an example off the top of my head, but there is material and it will take some time first of all to even explain what is a joint dependency. So essentially I will give you some intuition without going into the details. Can I get the white? I will just get the whiteboard. So if I have a relation R and I want to decompose it into two or more relations, R1, so join dependencies, say that, you know, supposing I can decompose R into these, some set like this, two or more. And if I can guarantee that for a particular way of decomposing it, this join is equal to R for any legal relation. So the point is, of course, for an arbitrary relation, if you break it up like this, the join may not give you back R. It is also clear that if you have appropriate functional dependencies, it could be a sufficient condition for the join to be equal to R. But it is not a necessary condition. A join dependency is a more general kind of thing. It says that the decomposition of R into these attributes, which of course have overlapping attributes between these, if we state that their join is equal to R, that is a join dependency. And multi-valued dependency, AMVD, alpha MVD beta, can be written in terms of a join dependency as alpha beta, R is decomposed into alpha beta and R minus beta, assuming alpha intersection beta equal to empty set for simplicity. This is the decomposition, alpha beta and R minus beta. A multi-valued dependency is equivalent to saying that the join of this is equal to R. Okay, there is no functional dependency, but multi-valued dependency is equivalent to a join dependency with two relations. But there are join dependencies involving three or more, decomposing into three or more parts, which are not equivalent to multi-valued dependencies. It is more general than that. And from that you get fifth normal form and so forth. Practically, I do not know anybody who uses it. This is very, very rare. I mean, I have not seen good examples of join dependencies which go beyond multi-valued dependencies. So note that these are more general. So it is actually a sequence. That is why we go from 4NF to 5NF. So anything which is in 4NF is automatically in 5NF because MVDs are a special case of join dependencies. Similarly, anything in BCNF is automatically in 4NF because you can show that functional dependencies are actually a very, very special case of multi-valued dependencies where the right hand side has only one value. In a multi-valued dependency, it can take on many values. In a functional dependency, it can only take on one value. So I'll leave it at that, and if you want to know more, go read it up. So as I said, we have material online. If you go to the book's website, there is an appendix on advanced normalization theory, and all these things are discussed in that appendix. At one point, it was in the printed book, but we decided that this is not something which your average course should go into. So we took it away and put it free on the web. Does that answer your question?
This is regarding a spatial database, sir. Is it possible to do normalization on a spatial DBMS, sir? Because we have lines and polygons instead of attributes or entities. So, is it really possible to do normalization in that?
So, the normalization theory does not really care about the type of the attribute. It could be ints, it could be strings, it could be lines, polygons, whatever. All that it says is if something is equal, something else must be equal. It does not care about the type. So even if you have a spatial database, you can certainly use normalization theory as is. But you can also look at the question another way. Are there any generalizations of whole theory of normalization if you take specific types into account, such as if you have a polygon, line segment and so on. Instead of just equality, there are other possibilities. You can say that if this is a subset of that, if A is a subset of B, then so the question is, can we somehow generalize functional, we had already functional dependencies, we had multi-value dependencies, we had joint dependencies. Can we come up with new types of dependencies specific to spatial data? I do not know if this is of any use, but maybe we can have a contains dependency, right? So we can say A contains dep B whenever you have two tuples A1, B1, A2, B2. You can say that if A1, I'll say contains by subset of equal to A2 implies B1 subset of equal to B2. Okay, this is just something I am coming up with on the fly. Okay, I have not thought about this. But it is just an idea which I had triggered by your question. So maybe we can create a new type of dependency which might actually make sense in the context of a spatial database. And now we can maybe come up with a whole normalization theory related to it. I do not know if this has any applicability or any use, but hey, maybe normalization theory is not fully dead yet. Maybe there is a little bit of life somewhere, little juice somewhere which you can squeeze and extract from it. Maybe, I do not know, if this might not lead anywhere, but it might lead somewhere. Okay, we will take a last question. This is from KLE Hubli.
Sir, how is BCNF different from third normal form?
Okay, so how is BCNF different from 3NF? This was the definition of BCNF. Okay, so we say a relation schema R is in BCNF with respect to a set of F of functional dependencies. If for all functional dependencies in F plus of the form alpha determines beta, where both alpha and beta are subsets of R, at least one of the following holds. Either it is trivial or alpha is a super key for R. This was the definition of BCNF. If you skip ahead to 3NF, this part is actually the same. I mean, I have abbreviated it on this slide, but the first part of it is exactly the same as the BCNF definition. The only difference is that in BCNF, we said at least one of the following holds. Either it is trivial or it is a super key. In 3NF, we are adding a third option. Either it is trivial or it is a super key, or each attribute A in the right hand side minus the left hand side, each attribute A in this part is contained in a candidate key for R. That is the only other option which we have added. So it is a weakening of BCNF. If it satisfies BCNF, it trivially satisfies 3NF, because every functional dependency will satisfy one or this, but if it satisfies 3NF, it may or may not satisfy BCNF, because maybe a particular dependency failed these two, but it satisfied the third one. Okay, I'll just check if there's any other relevant chat question, and then we will wrap up today. Yeah, somebody asked, what is domain key normal form? That is something which goes even beyond fifth NF, and you know, I don't want to get into it now, but as I said, the book's website has more information on all these advanced normalization theory. So DKNF, domain key normal form, is defined there. Again, none of this is really used in practice for multiple reasons. First of all, once you go beyond 4NF, for 4NF there are axioms, just like Armstrong's axioms. There are axioms which let you infer all the possible 4NF. So if I give you multivalued dependencies, I can infer other multivalued dependencies using a set of axioms. And maybe there are algorithms similar to attribute closure which could be used for it, I am not sure. But there are axioms for sure. Now, if you go beyond 4NF, if you go to joint dependencies and so on, it has been shown that there is no procedure like this. There is no set of rules which let you infer it. And when there is no such set of rules, it is very hard to reason about these things in any clean way. So both theoreticians and practitioners don't really use these things. But sometimes, you know, the intuition behind these forms shows up and makes sense. So even though in general it is hard to infer things from this, in specific cases it is intuitively clear, and sometimes you can use it to aid in normalization. But I don't know if anybody uses it as a routine thing. Yeah, I think that's it on the chat. So I think we have taken up a good deal of your time, way beyond, and I'm very happy that so many of you stayed back and asked so many questions. Thank you.